Hello everyone, welcome back to online classes of Vivekananda PU College, and I'm Suprit Kesi. We are discussing organism and population in previous classes. I think in last class we just stepped into the concept known to be the parasitism, where we just went through the introduction part of parasitism, or what do you mean by parasite. In today's class we will continue that, and we will see what are the examples you can have in parasitism, as well as what are the types of parasites that are available in the nature, and for the example for them too, as well as if we have a time we will discuss commensalism. Dear students, we already know what you mean by parasitism. Parasitism, it is a population interaction where one organism is benefited and another organism will be harmed. Of course, for a population interaction, if it need to be carried out, there should be an interaction between two organisms. Out of the two organisms, one should be getting benefit and this should be getting harm. Then this interaction can known to be the parasitism. Fine. The parasitism concept which run by the interaction of two organism, one known to be the parasite and another known to be the host. One known to be the parasite and another known to be the host. Nothing but the organism which absorb or obtain all kind of a resource from another organism known to be the parasite. Where parasites are living, from where parasites obtaining all the resource known to be the host. In the case of parasite athava parasitism, we have two organisms, one known to be the parasites, another known to be the host. By the interaction of a parasite and host, I can have a concept of parasitism. Parasite are the organism which absorbing or obtaining all the resources from the host. Host is an organism in which the parasites are living. This interaction can be of different types that I can discuss in bit later. Dear students, in the parasitism, one organism always getting benefit, another organism will be left behind with a loss. How? See, this is the organism which preparing the food, which in which it is having a perfect system. But in the case of parasite, this parasite organism obtained all the resources from the host. So whatever the things that prepared by the host will be lost by the parasite. So who will be having the loss? Exactly, host. Who is having the gain? Exactly, that is parasite. This is known to be the parasitism. Parasitism. Okay. Dear students, you must know, in human liver fluke, human liver fluke, it require two organisms to complete its life cycle. One is a snail, okay. Another one is known to be the fish. I repeat, human liver fluke require two organism to complete its life cycle. One is a snail, another one is fish. Fine. Now there is another organism known to be the malaria parasite, or malaria parasite. Okay, this require a mosquito for the reproduction pattern. This require mosquito for the reproduction. To complete the journey of life, by the parasite, they require host. If there is no host, there is no life cycle, there is no continuation of generation, at the end of the day, the parasite will end up with a disaster. This is the story. In last class, maybe I have discussed what are the adaptations that acquired by the parasites, right? Fine. The parasite does not have an unnecessary sense organ. There is no unnecessary sense organ at all. There is no requirement, right?
Okay, fine.
Accepted. Next, parasite don't have much digestive glands. There is no necessity because whatever the food produced by the host will be absorbed by the parasite. So there is no requirement at all. Correct. So the digestion glands are absent. Fine. Okay. These organisms that are parasite, it is consisting adhesive organs. Adhesive. To hold something, okay, or to obtain something from somewhere, okay, like suckers, those kind of organs they acquired, they have. This is the thing. And they have higher reproductive rate, because they don't, face any threats, or there is no, limited resource. All the food, all the shelter, whatever the nourishment or the comfort zone they require will be obtained from the host. So there is no much threat, right? So there will be a continuation of generation by the high reproductive rate. Those are the adaptations possessed by your parasites. Okay. What are the harm caused by the parasite to the host? That may be the question arising in your mind, right? What are the harms caused by parasite to the host? Dear students, parasite will harm the host. Harm the host. Okay. It will decrease the population density of the host. Density of the host, as well as the parasite will decrease the survival of the host. Also, it will decrease the growth and development of the host. I repeat, it will cause the harmness to the host, right? Exactly. And even it will decrease the population density, survival rate, growth, as well as the development of the host. Very good. Of the host. Fine. Then, after obtaining all the resources from the host, host become very weaker. Correct? So that it become vulnerable for the predators. Okay, these are the harmness caused by parasite to the host. I repeat, it will harm the host. How it will harm? See, I just mentioned they'll have adhesive glands, hook or suckers, okay? It will attach to the body of the host, right? It will harm the host. Even the population density, survival rate, as well as growth and development will be lost by the host. And at the end of the day, because of all the nourishment acquired by the parasite from the host, and all this process carried by the host will weaken by the host, which is caused by the parasite, so that it become vulnerable for the predators. These are the harmness caused by the parasite to the host. Fine. Okay. Then let us jump on to the types of the parasites. Types. Are you people ready? Yes. Thank you. So, in broadly classification, I can have three types of parasitism. In my nature, if I start to do the research or start to find it out, I can have three kind of parasitism. which is very simple as well as very important too. Dear students, in my nature, I can find three kinds of parasitism. Three kinds. One is ectoparasite or parasitism, endoparasite or parasitism, endoparasitism. Then the third one is brood parasitism. Okay. Ectoparasitism, ectoparasitism, endoparasitism, brood parasitism, brood parasitism. Okay, ectoparasitism, endoparasitism, brood parasitism. These are the three types I can have under parasitism. I repeat, ecto, endo and brood parasitism. Ectoparasitism, endoparasitism as well as brood parasitism. Okay. So what do you mean by ectoparasitism? Ecto. Ecto means outside, right? Okay. Ectoparasitism, it is a parasitism in which parasites are living outside of the host or a surface of the host. Okay. Parasites living outside of the host body or surface of the host. Living in surface of the host. Surface of the host. These are the parasites living in the surface of the host or outer of host body. Out of the surface of the host body. What are the examples you can take for this ectoparasitism? You can have a common example in around. Okay. First one, the basic one. Okay. Basic one. Lice in human. Okay. Then ticks in dog. Lice in human, ticks in dog. Then in marine fishes you can find copepods in marine organisms or fishes, marine organisms. Copepods means kind of a crustaceans, okay, copepods. Then even the life of cuscuta in hedge plants. These are all the examples of your ectoparasites or ectoparasitism. Lice in human, ticks in dog, copepods in marine organism, cuscuta in hedge plants. These are all the examples. Okay. Fine. Now we are going to discuss about the endoparasite, but before that you must know cuscuta does not have a chlorophyll at all. Okay, it cannot produce its own food. So this food will be obtained from the host plant where it is living. From the host plant, the cuscuta obtaining all the resource, all kind of a food. And even we have a female mosquito, right? Yes. This mosquito, it is just require our blood to carry out the process of reproduction. Okay, not for the survival. So the mosquito, okay, all mosquito, they require, especially female, they require the blood from the other organisms to carry out the process of reproduction, not for survival. That is the difference you must know. These are about the ectoparasitism or ectoparasites. Now I am going to talk about endoparasites. I think you already know the definition of endoparasitism or endoparasites. Okay. Fine. Okay. In the case of endoparasitism, endo means inside, right? Whatever the, if the parasites are living inside the host body, it is known to be the endoparasitism. Whatever the liver flukes we have, whatever the worms we have inside our body, all they can be the examples of endoparasitism. In the case of endoparasitism, you must know, my dear students, there will be greater adaptations of endoparasite inside our host body, or there will be a great change compared to those organs which are living outside. What are the adaptations they acquired? We will going to see that. Fine. In the case of endoparasitism, the organisms or the parasites are living inside the host. Living inside. Very good. Inside the host. Inside of the host. Okay. In the case of the organism which are living inside of the host, they will show very simple morphological and anatomical pattern. They will have very simple morphology or anatomy. Morphology as well as anatomy. They will have simple morphology as well as anatomy. Who will have simple morphology and anatomy? Who? Yes, exactly, that is endoparasites. Fine. As well as the simple morphology or anatomy, these organisms will have a higher reproductive rate. Higher reproductive rate. Why they have higher reproductive rate? Exactly, they don't have any threats inside of the host, right? All the resources like food, space, or the continuation of generation will acquire inside the host. They will have a production there. They will have a unlimited food resource. They will come in the comfort zone, so as to they will start to expand as much as possible. This is a story. Okay, they will have simple morphology or anatomy, and they have a higher reproductive rate. This is about your endoparasites. Okay, now we are going to talk about brood parasitism. This is again a population interaction where the parasites are laying eggs in the nest of the host. Parasites are laying eggs in the nest of the host. So all the incubation that is required to hatch the egg will be the responsibility of the host. Okay, these organisms which are laying the eggs in the nest of the host, known to be the parasite, which are giving the incubation and have the egg, known to be the host here, in the case of brood parasitism. Okay, best example you can give for brood parasitism, that is cuckoo and crow. Okay, this is about brood parasitism, cuckoo and crow. Best example for parasitism. As the time passes, as the evolution passes, okay, the egg color of the crow, okay, egg color of the crow is changing, okay, as to differentiate the eggs of a cuckoo and crow. the cuckoo, whatever the eggs they are laying, it is going to change. It is changing. Simultaneously, cuckoo also changing the egg pattern, egg color pattern, as the same as the crow. This is the evolution pattern of these two interactions. Okay, this is about brood parasitism. We have studied ectoparasites, endoparasite, brood parasites. I think this is the ending of the story in the case of parasitism. Now we are going to talk about commensalism. Then we have amensalism as well as mutualism. Commensalism. Okay. Commensalism. Again, this is a population interaction, a type of population interaction where one organism getting benefit and another organism neither benefited nor harmed. This is very simple, okay? Population interaction, okay, where one organism getting benefited, other organism neither benefited nor harmed. This is the story. Okay. I repeat, in the case of commensalism, it is just a population interaction where one organism is benefited and other organism neither benefited nor harmed. Okay. Species A I have, species B I have, one is benefited, another one neither benefited nor harmed. Positive sign shows a beneficial effect. Zero shows there is no loss or there is no gain. Neither benefited nor harmed. Okay. This is your commensalism. In the case of commensalism, we have many examples. The first example I can take is the life of orchids. Life of orchids in a mango tree. They act as epiphyte. All the nutrition or the nourishment which are required for the life of orchids will be obtained from the mango tree. Fine. That is the first example. As second example, I can give you the example of life of barnacle, kind of arthropoda, barnacle, on the surface of whale. Barnacle on surface of whale fish. Here in the case of orchids getting benefit, right? But in the case of mango, there is no benefit, there is no harm. Exactly. In the case of barnacle and whale interaction, barnacle getting a benefit. But what about the whale? There is no benefit, there is no harmness. Okay. These are the two best examples. Again, I can take an interaction of clownfish as well as sea anemone. Yes. Clownfish and sea anemone and clownfish. Okay. Clownfish are living in the tentacles of a sea anemone. Tentacles of a sea anemone. so that the clownfish are obtaining a protection. In the case of sea anemone, there is no beneficial effect or there is no harmness. So plus symbol goes to clone. For sea anemone, it is zero. This is the population interaction of a commensalism. Even I can take an example of cattle. Cattle and cattle egret, where cattle egret obtaining all the benefits. In the case of cattle, there is no benefit at all. Even there is no harm at all. How cattle egrets are getting benefit? Dear students, you just have imagination where you have a land area filled with the grasses. There you have a cattle as well as cattle egret you have. As the grazing process is happening, the cattle is keep on eating the grasses. Whatever the insects are hiding behind those grasses or the food of the cattle, okay, they will start to expose more, right? Because of the greater exposure, these insect will start to escape from the area of grazing, okay. When they escape, they can easily catch up or picked by the cattle egret, so that these are obtained the food. This is again the population interaction of, that is, commensalism. Here cattle egret getting a benefit of food, but cattle don't getting any benefit as well as there is no harm at all. These are all the examples. Yes, these are the examples. The best examples are orchids and mango interaction, barnacle as well as whale interaction, clone fish and sea anemone interaction, at the end cattle and cattle egret interaction. These are all the examples of commensalism. Commensalism is nothing but the population interaction where one organism getting benefit, another organism neither benefit or nor harm. Fine. I think this much is enough for you today. We are left behind with the mutualism as well as amensalism that we can discuss in next class. I hope you enjoyed this class, and thank you for your patient listening. Stay at home, stay safe, take care, and bye.